the conscious creation of a new nation with a clear and well-defined unifying purpose established by eternal principles and driven by lofty ideals. So it's on this stubbornness, because there are many people out there who don't believe that a new nation is possible. But we know different. You know, it's going to take grit, you know. One of the reasons why I'm doing what I'm doing is because I don't have any other nation. And I know how people who move to other nations are treated as second-class citizens because it's not their nation, you know. And sometimes I feel very sad for people who leave this nation and go abroad and they are criticizing this nation, you know, not knowing that it takes all of us. Nigeria is in the state it is today because all of us failed. You know, it's not just one group of people that failed us. All of us failed. And the quicker we rise up to the realization that this is the only nation we have and that we can make, transform this nation. You know, those who say Nigeria can never be transformed, they are lying. You know, they are lying. Can I get a witness in the house? They are lying. Nothing is impossible. Absolutely nothing is
impossible. This is not an official meeting. It's not an official meeting. So there's nothing formal about it. It's the same thing like in your community or in your village, in your house or in your home, you have a problem. I decide to call village meeting. Let's discuss our problems. How do we step away from here? We do call family meetings, right?
Yes.
In our neighborhood, I just had like, last week, a couple of weeks ago, in my neighborhood, there was an issue. And we are the stakeholders that we are coming together to just find a way of stepping ahead of this problem. Solve our own problem because we believe that the strength and the power is in us. We don't need anyone to do that.
Now, the New Nigeria is Possible Movement is a coalition made up of civil society organizations and NGOs and individuals, you know. We all had different things we were doing, you know, but with the same focus, you know, and as Providence will have it, we began to connect with each other. That's the story, the full story, we will tell you some other time. But we began to connect with each other and we began to find out that we had one thing in common, and that's the belief in Nigeria, and that it's our responsibility to do whatever needs to be done to bring forth the full establishment and the full transformation of our dearly beloved nation.
My name is Colette Bullet. How many of you can collect the bullet for Nigeria? That's the question. So you don't have to ask me, I'm already in. How many of us are in?
Absolutely.
You're not in, I am still in front.
Right, and the whole aim of the assembly, like I said, is to gather people of like minds so that we can speak together, you know, we can contribute our ideas, we can synergize, you know, we can work together to do what needs to be done so that we can bring about the full transformation of our dearly beloved nation.
So who is Magufuli? He's a Tanzanian. He was born in 29th October 1959. He served 2 terms as a minister, and the same 2015 he was elected as the president of Tanzania, the fifth president of Tanzania. Why? Exemplary leader, selfless, he's anti-corruption, he's a builder, he has social care, he's a change activist like most of us here, and he's a humanist. Why did we say so? As an exemplary leader and selfless leader, he first banned himself. Not this one, you make rules and you are still the breaker of the rule. He banned himself first. How did he ban himself? See, number one, his salary. Because the heart of a man is where his treasure is. So he started with his salary and dropped it from $15,000. That's a mistake. It's $15,000 to $4,000. How many of you can do that?
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ibrahim Adam. I'm the founder of African Dynamics Action Movement.
My name is Dr. Edward Abai. Thanks for having me.
I come to find out about New Nigeria Assembly. I just got the flyer somewhere, and then I just cut it up. And the first name I saw, Dr. Oga, I just gave him a call. And today I'm here. I'm one of you.
What is, you said, the cost of the old Nigeria
and the price
of the new one? I will choose the price for the new one because I want to have old. I have seen what colonization of the mind, not colonization of the people, have done that.
And we are not fighting because we want to live as human beings. We are fighting because we want to live like animals. When we got independent, or so-called independent in 1960, there was nothing like independent. The British has already established their business, everything. All they do is just to siphon what they siphon. Whatever is stolen from Nigeria, or in, from Nigeria, for example, 60 to 70% is in London, is in Britain, from Nigeria. And those are the people we still go to ask them to come and help us. What we want is true dedication. True dedication. What did I say? True dedication. Just dedicate yourself. The truth. The truth.
When I saw a young man there, I was very happy because if I was there, I would have brought my children to this place. So I would plead for all of us that want to be in this Nigeria, please sing this like a song to your children. Because the most difficult one is the mental slavery.
Yeah.
These people, I was able to speak with one of them. They are not interested in any work. They're just interested in the money that comes at the end of the day. So when you see the amnesty program of the Niger Delta, that is a mental slavery. So when you see people, next time you see people, they give you free money and they put you on the pay for 2-3 years. That is mental enslavement. Because it limits your ability to reason. So the new Nigeria I am envisaging is one that people that we are hardworking. I remember when Professor Yemi Osinbajo was speaking, I was monitoring when they were coming the Oba of Benin. He said that a Portuguese historian wrote in 1780-something, that the Benin monarchy had boulevard with street lights. That was what I can put in what he said. Which means there was real development in Africa. I agree with what the Prime Minister said, which means that let us grow our own Nigeria.
Yes.
And that price is far, far, far cheaper than the mental slavery if we allow ourselves to go that road. So
we are ready to sacrifice our life to bring Nigeria to where it's supposed to be. Because this is not the Nigeria that we're supposed to be.
Yes,
this is not the Nigeria that we're dreaming for. I'm 58 years old now. I started African Dynamics Actions Movement in 1992. Up to this moment, I have only 44 members. I'm satisfied with that. Because I refuse to compromise my relationship with God. And I will never do that. So I'm happy I'm one of you, this new Nigeria Assembly. We are building a family that will liberate Africa. Just take it. We are building a family that will liberate Africa. Even if we did not see Africa liberated, we're going to lay a foundation, a great foundation, for the next generation to come. I said, Africa restoration doesn't mean that they should give us money. They should leave us alone. Let's think on our own.
Yes.
Don't give us money. We didn't need your money. We didn't need anything. Leave us on our own. You have your ideas, you're a black man. She has an idea as a black man. You have your ideas as a black man. I'm going to have my own ideas as a black man. It shall not be in vain. Let's dedicate ourselves, our resources, our spirit to God. The hands of God is in Nigeria.
Yes.
So we need people with good ideas, people who will dedicate themselves to the service of this nation. Today, 2015 to 2021, we have lost the life more than 5 times the one that was lost in the Civil War. And we are not fighting more with other countries. So what are we talking about? Can we continue lying to ourselves? The greatest stupid, the greatest fool, is the one that lies to himself. Abraham Lincoln contested, and what he comes to do is that he looked at his people, he said, let's tell the people the truth and save our nation. And by what the people received, and he won the election. Today everybody is running to America. We want to build a country that our black people from anywhere will say we have a home.
Yes.
We're going to our home.
So, who can guess the person who did this video? She's in our midst. Someone who doesn't know her, who just came here today. Who can guess the lady? Doctor, put your hands together for this beautiful young lady. That's
see her face. You
know, I mean, normally when you see young, beautiful ladies like that, they are not fighting for Nigeria. You know what they are fighting for? No, no, they took for here.
Wall Street.
You know, for this one, can collect a bullet for Nigeria. Mm-hmm. You know, she's been fighting for this nation for a long time. Let's put our hands together. So we have the YouTube channel, Berry Bullet. You know, you can go there and check her out. She's one of us, you know, and we're doing this thing together. Thank you very much. That was awesome.
So I am going for the winner.
Thank you.
Yeah,
but I am Dr. Amaka Okafor. I came here to request of my very good friend. I had always wanted to come, but today I said I must come. Even though we had to go and see an in-law that is in the hospital, I said I must come. So sorry, I was a bit late. As a mother and a woman, no matter how much as a parent you're bad, you want the best for your children.
Yes.
So I remember one day my son came in. He's always talking about Usman, his friend. That my father now started calling him Usman. So one day he kept saying, Usman this, Usman that, Usman this. I now said, who is Usman? He said, it's his good friend. And what struck me was my own inadequacy as a parent. One of our neighbors is, they are from the north, I think Kano, so I'm not so sure. Once in a while we say hello, when I have a child they come, I go to them when they have an event, when they send round, I go and see them.
My name is Lemmy. Now I ask that because we are going through a very difficult time, and if you understand it well, and you are working on the lessons of this time, then a new Nigeria is possible. But if you do not understand it and walk towards a new Nigeria, all we do here is rhetoric.
And it's not because I am too busy, but because of that divide that has been sown in us.
We don't know when it starts. So when my son kept talking about Usmanana, I said, where did we get it wrong? We are too afraid of our neighbors. Something happens in the office and I'm like, isn't all this your grandma? But, and I kept thinking over and over and over, where did we get this wrong? So it comes to emancipation of our minds.
Yes.
How do we separate ourselves from this thing that has been sown in us?
What is the pride of a new Nigeria? We've talked about emancipation. But the point is that there is what? Self-sacrifice. You have to die. You have to kill yourself. Kill in inverted comma. You have to sacrifice you. We have the ENSAS situation. A country moved on like nothing ever happened. The price is to be angry enough to say we must change the status quo. And being angry is not social media activism alone.
True.
We must restore the power of the people through the ballot box. When our politicians know that we can vote them out, they will perform. So the electoral reform, we must make it an issue. We have come here, we have said a lot of, there's no difference, you and I. Yes, we have a common humanity. But if there is, if hypocrisy is not gotten rid of, and if there is no sincerity, which is the price we must pay, otherwise we are deceiving ourselves. Hypocrisy is what makes us to have one love from the north, for the north, and one love for the south.
You alone, God has put us together. For a certain reason, God never makes mistakes. If something is wrong with you today, it's because God knows that. So that God has put us in this country is for a reason. That you're in a position to help, it's for a reason. That you have a neighbor that is Hausa, it's for a reason. I could have been in the East, all my neighbors are in Janasu. It is the same thing. But that He has put me here, and I have as a colleague, Yoruba man, someone from Apaibo. It's for a reason. What we should look at is what is our common goal. Mm. We will not all be here for a long time. If your child is alone and he has a friend at Hausa, why won't you teach your child to love and be comfortable with that person?
So and we must trace where we got it wrong. If in 1992-93, the Abiola Kingibe election had stood, you and I will never talk about tribe and tongue and religion because then we did not care.
Yeah.
And it's the reason I can never pay any good words for IBB. Yes, because he ruined the chance of Nigeria never to think about tribe and religion. Abiola went to Kano and beat Othman Bashiru Tofa. The same kind of that you say, if you are not a northerner, a outsider, you can never win election. Abiola won
that for this context. So I just want to show you that there are certain natural balances, natural principles that are already existing in life. It guides both humans and animals. It's not about prayer. Prayer won't change them. It helps me to know when to pray and when not to pray. There are things you need to act and get the result. You don't need prayer because the principles cannot change. If it's a law that there has to be a sacrifice, there has to be a pain before gain. If it's a law, and those who are Christians, if the same creator understands that law, he was not in heaven to do abracadabra for this to change. He sent someone to come in human form and pass through sacrificial process to maintain that principle because he himself cannot break it. You want the blessings of Abraham, but you don't care what Abraham went through to get the blessings. Abraham's blessings are mine, everybody raise up their hands. But the process you don't want to know. Now, if you like, pray from now to eternity. If you don't do what we are supposed to do to get where we're supposed to get, nothing will change. And that's why I bring some of these principles like actions and reactions.
So we must trace these roots. Then above all, self-dignity. You must sacrifice your selfishness and have self-dignity, integrity. If you have dignity, integrity becomes the major commodity you sell, the major value. And I say, until Nigerians get to the point that tribe, tongue, religion, money, survival, stomach infrastructure will never make you say this white is off-white or cream. Because integrity is the key of what can restore us.
You have the fortune and misfortune. Fortune and misfortune is a very interesting principle as well. That tells us that every misfortune you find in this world, every misfortune or fortune you find in this world that happens to you or happens to someone is balanced by the counter, same way, by the counter action to someone else. So if my, like I buried my dad a couple of weeks ago, he died. Even in my arms, I kissed him goodbye and I smiled because I've understood certain principles. As that was happening, the mortuary person that's supposed to pay some bills was already jubilating. The casket seller, all of them. So that loss translated to fortune to some people. And they smiled. And this is the reason that the problem in this country will never go so easily if you're all watching and holding your hands looking, because out of every misfortune of the country, some people benefit. It pays off. It happens. Your car breaks down, the mechanic will smile. Your child gets sick, the hospital, they pay their bills. They have also bills to pay. And it's balanced. You get a job, you're happy. Ah, mommy, I got a job. Somebody lost that job. Now, we have the choices and consequences. That is there. The choices we are making today, the consequences will come. And let me tell you, even silence is a choice. Yeah. Don't say, I do not belong, no, I don't want to belong. No, it's a choice. It's a choice, and the consequence definitely come there. So you have the pains and gains, time and seasons. These are pains that are natural, they are just there.
For my own children, they are both undergraduates. They know, father, before the day, yes, before the day, that this white I can no longer call it white. Father, take me out of this world before that day. So can you speak about Nigeria and to power fearlessly? Or you will think of survivor. I do not have 6 digits in my account. But you know what? I walk taller than most of the big men. Because people pray for me every day because they know who I am and what I represent. So until we get there, before we will get the vision of the new Nigeria, which is possible, which is realizable, we started from here, but it is possible. Thank you.
Now, I'll take you to an interesting concept now. This is the one I don't want to talk about today. And others will follow. Human instincts and animalistic instincts. Every human being is made up of these two instincts. Every human being. All animals, what I mean, and anything living that has the biological constructs to this, breathing, walking, eating, we all have this. All animals. Including lion and fish and antelope in the bush or forest. We are all made of this. This is the instinct. What makes us different? What makes us different? Animals. Superior being from animals.
These ones.
That's why we are calling human being.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, many people are not human beings.
True.
Now, this is a higher realm of operation for humans. This other one is lower. And because it's lower, it's easily accessed. That's the one that's very easy.
Send them to Harvard, to the best schools. Give them the best job. If Nigeria still remains what it is today, we've not done anything for our children. That is a point to note. And I want to appeal to us that which we think is very difficult is an easy task. It's very easy. Like I said, anywhere you go to, they say, can we see a Nigeria we can trust? The nation is waiting for a people they can trust. It's not as if changing what is in the status quo is difficult, but the nation is yearning, can we see them? When they see them, they will know them. And that's why it's taking so much time. We've come a long way. A process is being built. Because when you are taking the people on a journey and you cannot show them the way, it becomes very difficult. And if you don't become that which you are interpreting to other people, they will never believe you.
Now, the survival of the fittest thing is what to find in the jungle. whoever that is stronger will survive. You don't care about others. You have the fight and conquer. That is the oligarchy kind of thing we are seeing. I will still come to somewhere. So you understand and forgive our leaders why they behave the way they behave. Human instinct, you have a conscience. We have this instinct. You don't know when something judges you inside. And this is the guy, the instinct that tells us right and wrong and tries to keep us on the path of right. You have the rule and order. We always want to have systems, things work in order. Oh no, you go first, okay, me go later. It doesn't happen in the jungle. Then you have this wisdom and knowledge. These are the instincts. You always want to know why. Curiosity. We don't have it, these guys don't care. Then spirituality, fine, absolutely fine. We always want to connect that supernatural being. We have that kind of connection. Unfortunately, this spirituality is what was translated in the context of animalistic instincts and it becomes religion. And we are going back to the center. Instead of practicing what we need to, connection with your supreme being. Then emotions, where you have love and hatred and so on. So what it means is that this guy, will, because he knows that he needs this thing, he would never think of shortchanging them, because if any of them dies, it is also going down. The same way with the body. He wanted to say something like that. The body, the heart, all the functions, the kidney, they keep working. They are working like their life depends on that job, because if the kidney fails, the whole body goes down. If the brain fails, everybody goes down.
So we are trying to have this small unit of us with that convincing attitude that people will see and they can trust. I'm telling you, the issue of whether you are from the north or south will no longer be, because people from the north, south, they've tested power and we've seen the animalistic instinct in them. And if we can have people with the humanistic instinct, whether you are from the north or south, it will no longer be a thing to worry about. So I must tell us, and I want to appeal to us, it's a process we started. It's a process. Let us not cut it off. Let's keep building. Nigeria is waiting for a people. I'm looking at, you know, this hall. We are already a people. Imagine how many people do Nigeria need to make impact from the presidency to the world level, not up to 2,000 or 3,000 people. Is it that we cannot have 2,000 credible leaders that we can build and we are sure that they are going to serve and to change what is against us?
And that's what we are. Now, what happened to the black man actually was, this thing I wanted to tell you. You know, during the slave trade and the colonization and everything, what happened was, all those processes, you've not read them, don't even bother. I didn't have the heart to look at those things that were there. But what happened that period was, they were completely dehumanized. Dehumanized means they removed all those human instincts that could have made them function like humans. And they're no longer functioning like real humans. So they now get hold on their animalistic instincts. Go and sell your brother. How many families? I know them. You go and tell them, carry them, slavery, bam. They're using you. Walking up and down, and you are doing what you are doing because you want to survive, you want to be favored. And that continued. And after the slavery, one of the things that happened then was that not only dehumanizing them, part of the dehumanization was their identity was completely removed. That's what they gave them, Oyibo name. Not their real name, they changed their names to whatever. And now I'm happily answering Henry, thinking that Henry is normal. We've completely lost it. We are now happily carrying long hairs, smiling like this. It's the colonial master's natural hair. It's not the natural hair. That's part of the dehumanization, removing the identity. We are now doing two weddings. We do the traditional wedding and do another man's traditional marriage, which is another white wedding, which is theirs.
Their own tradition.
Their own tradition. We are now speaking English, and we are happy when our children are speaking phonetics. What's my problem? Oh, you are so happy. But even your own language, he doesn't know how to speak. I'm also a victim and I'm not proud of it. So these are part of that. And that's why. So now that effect is what I was handed over from generation to generation to generation. That animalistic instinct. And that's what we all have. and we behave the way we behave. Because the human part, the human nature in us has been completely removed.
It's very easy. Let the processes that we have passed not continue to deceive us. Let the suffering not keep telling us that we cannot do it. We have the capacity and we can do it. We have a people. Even as we are sitting in this hall, people are there in different states who are already having the same yearning like all of us. All we need is that a day is coming, there will be a clarion call, and we see all of them rallying around, and we will produce the new Nigeria of our great dreams. Thank you for coming, and I want that as we are living here, all of us, please, we carry the spirit. And we have friends, we have family members, we all need to be knitted together in this pursuit. Because we have no other nation but Nigeria. And it's our responsibility to ensure that a new Nigeria emerges. Thank you so much.
And we never leave. Now, I want to tell you about these two institutions of humanization. Actually, these two institutions, education and spirituality, are the two things that should have sustained, developed our human nature and sustain it. Education will bring about the wisdom and knowledge. That is where you hear knowledge is power. That's what education should have done. Then the spirituality will bring about the conscience, emotions. Which other one I mentioned?
Love.
Eh?
Love.
Thank you. And order. Otherness. That is what spirituality should do. Unfortunately, like I said, we are still struggling in the same black man animalistic instinct that we have inherited. We've turned our spirituality to religion. That is the context of spirituality in the animalistic instinct. Then the religion brings about division, and we are still killing. Something that should happen. So these two things is what should be reminding us that we are human. This is how it's supposed to be. We are superior beings than the animals. We shouldn't be behaving like animals. But unfortunately, we lost them. And a whole population of a black man, they refuse to send them to school. Because the education is what will give you the ability for critical reasoning. If they ask you, go and carry a ballot box, I'll pay you 2,000, run away. You will sit down and process it. And process it. The first thing is, what of his children? Where are they? Why should I be the one to carry a ballot box? And the critical thinking will also tell you that you have stayed 4 years, you didn't die. Why would you collect 5,000 to vote for another torment, torture, another 4 years? If I don't collect 3,000 today, I won't die. If I survived 4 years, I didn't die. Why? These are the kind of things that education will tell you. Now, and these two is what should have led to civilization, which we are lacking.
Is we learning about how money works. And how money works is by developing interest in manufacturing. All of us here can register a company and manufacture something for export. Even if we can't manufacture, we can just go to the farm and export a non-oil export product, agro product. So I encourage all of us here to get a plot of land and start agri-business.
And now the typical human society of today, I'm now coming down to the mentor B, and about my last. The typical human society of today is when we have the old Nigeria, which is driven by these animalistic instincts, both leaders and followers. So don't stand here and point at anybody. Yeah. All of us, including me, I've told you several things I'm not proud of, but I just found myself in it. So that is the mindset, the programming we are working with. So when you see a leader carrying 20 billion, only him, in a position of 20 million, we are just becoming animals. Jungle justice, the kind of killing you see. The human instinct in you, the human nature in you, shouldn't have done all that, but it's completely lost. And that's what we're doing. And why are we here? We are here to see how can we graduate from these animalistic instincts back to where we belong, which is the human nature that makes me human.
Yes.
The Magufuli that they mentioned in Tanzania, there are still people who still reserve, and many of us here, for coming here today, they're a human being. So let me just talk about this NSAS. Why was NSAS exceptional? Quickly, do you think NSAS failed or was successful?
Failed.
Successful. Hands up. So now the difference between the old Nigeria and the new Nigeria is a gradual process. First, let me tell you how we're going to get there. First, it starts with knowledge that we've lost.
We are here to gain that knowledge, to see things differently. Secondly, awareness of our identity. Who are we? So you're not in a hurry to go and belong to someone else. You run from here, go to the US. In the next 1 year or few days, you are there shouting Black Lives Matter in another man's country. Who told you the country was made for you? You left your own country, you go there, doing Black Lives Matter. Now, the third one is the willingness. From awareness, we are now willing to go to where, to the promised land where you belong. Fourth one is readiness to make sacrifices. That is the price. So sacrifice is the price of the new Nigeria. Are you ready to now pay the price? Because it's not easy. Already, we are already at this level. How do you move to the next level? If you are ready to pay, make sacrifices, then the only thing you need to do is to build the new Nigeria from inside out, not from outside in. Don't wait for your brother to change. Yeah. Start it from inside, expand it to your neighbors, communities, and so on and so forth. And I think we are done. So thank you so much, everyone.
My name is Andrew Suleiman. This is my first time for being in the West. Welcome. Thank you very much. What I want to say is simple. We don't need a crowd to bring about positive change in any society. If you go down history globally, including America today that we are looking up to, America have gone through what we are going through today. And even the French people and several other countries too. If you go through their history, you'll discover that it's either an individual or a few group of people who actually brought those changes that have been built upon over time today. So we actually do not really need a big crowd to achieve the change. Once a people propose or an individual propose a thing in his or her heart and follows through, there is a spirit that naturally backs it for achievement. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I think for me, one of the major things I learned from the NSATs is that a new Nigeria where all our distinctions and differences disappear and dissolve is possible.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, that's what we learned. People were thinking, and even the people that were attacking them, they were taking care of them.
Yeah.
The talks were being taken care of by the people who were being attacked. You know, I understand what Mars is saying. It should have led to a complete change of hope. But that's going to happen.
That was not the intention.
That was not the intention. Because actually, well, what's the one happened? Because what happened, this guy that was killed in somewhere in Edo, so that's what sparked up the initial sentence. Yeah. Well, the new Nigeria is here.
Is here, absolutely.
Do you know why I say it's here? Because you are here. You believe in the new Nigeria. And because you carry it in your heart, then the new Nigeria is here. All right. There are other things we do as the New Nigeria is Possible movement. One of the things we have planned is called the Weapon Reconciliation Conference. Weapon simply means we, the people of Nigeria, Reconciliation Conference. That one is built for August. We'll tell you more about it. It's all going to sit down face to face, you know, gather ourselves, representatives from all over Nigeria, 200-300 people, and we'll look at ourselves eyeball to eyeball and apologize for all the different hurts and pains that we have caused one another and bring about the reconciliation. We believe that that singular act will cause a ripple effect in the spiritual realm that will affect the whole of Nigeria and reset things. You know, we'll keep you posted. We have a website already existing for that purpose.
Find your partner. Go get partner. One man. I don't know.